Hello and welcome to Set Theory, a bite-sized lecture series. In these videos, you'll get a conceptual overview of set theory that doesn't take all day. If you're new to this channel, be sure to check out the playlist with all the videos in this series, which I'll link to in a card in the corner of the screen. Last week, we talked about cardinality of finite and countably infinite sets. This week, we're going to talk about uncountably infinite sets. Specifically, we're going to talk about something fundamental to understanding uncountable sets, the axiom of choice. So let's say we have five boxes, and in each box there are five indistinguishable cats. We want to choose one cat from each box and put all of those cats in another funner box over here. Well, this situation is totally fine. We're allowed to pick one element from one set using, I believe, the subset axiom. No axiom of choice necessary. We just go to the first box, boop, second box, boop, and so on for all five boxes. Now let's say we have Aleph-Knot boxes, again, each with five indistinguishable cats. Recall that Aleph-Knot is the size of the set of natural numbers, aka countable infinity. Well, once again, this is no problem. We simply use the fact that these boxes are countable, go to the first box, pick a cat from that box, then the second box, and so on. The issue arises when we have uncountably many boxes. We can no longer use the fact that we're allowed to pick one cat from one box because we don't even know how to pick a box if we want to make sure that we're hitting each one. This is where the axiom of choice comes in. The axiom of choice tells us, it's okay if you can't figure out how to order these boxes so you can pick from each and every one. I'm telling you that there is some way to pick a cat from each box anyway. Even if we're not sure exactly what's in this super fun chosen set over here, which will be uncountably infinite, the axiom of choice tells us that at least it exists. This seems like a pretty intuitive idea. We should be able to pick elements out of sets no matter how many there are. That's why we accept the axiom of choice as an axiom. We can't prove it, but we want it to be true, and we want to use it to prove a bunch of other stuff later on. Historically, the axiom of choice was not always accepted by mathematicians. Nowadays, it's pretty much accepted, at least in regular level set theory. But its controversial past means that when we use it, we are technically narrowing ourselves down into a more specific type of set theory. So everything we've done before now has been part of Zermelo-Frankel set theory, or ZF. But when we use the axiom of choice, we are transported to a subset of ZF called ZFC, or Zermelo-Frankel set theory with the axiom of choice. So now, we sort of understand what the axiom of choice is trying to say. But in set theory, we always want to formalize everything, so there are six official forms of the axiom of choice. The first four are equivalent, and you'll see that they all basically say what we just described, but the last two are a little bit different, and we will get there when we get there. So form one of the axiom of choice states, for any relation R, there is a function f, a subset of R, with the domain of f equal to the domain of R. Our relation R maps each element in the domain to some stuff in the range. It could be one thing, it could be a bunch of things, but then the function f goes to each element in the domain and chooses one element in the range that that element maps to. Because while a relation can map one input to multiple different outputs, a function must map each input to one and only one output, so it has to choose, from the different outputs that it could be, choose only one output. It's actually easiest to explain why this is equivalent to choosing stuff from a bunch of sets if we do it alongside Form 2. So Form 2 states, if h is a function with domain I, and if for all little I in I, h of I is non-empty, then there is a function f with domain I such that for all little I in I, f of I is in h of I. That is a really long statement, but what it basically is saying is that h is a function that takes elements in the domain and maps them to non-empty sets. For every h, we can then define another function f that takes those same elements and maps each of them to one element in the set that h mapped them to. Personally, I think it's easier to see why form 2 is the same as the axiom of choice. We take a bunch of sets, all the h of i's, and we choose one element from each of these h of i's to be f of I. And now we can finally explain why form 1 is the same as the axiom of choice. In form 1, instead of mapping each element in the domain to a set h of I, we've mapped it to some elements in the range of R. For each input, the set of outputs in the range of R is equivalent to h of I. So in form 1, when we're picking one output for each input, what we're really doing is just picking one f of I from each h of I. Form 3 of the Axiom of Choice states, for any set A, there is a function f such that the domain of f is the set of non-empty subsets of A, and such that f of B is in B, for every non-empty set B which is a subset of A. Again, a very long statement, but it's basically the exact same thing as Form 2, except instead of sets in the range of some function, the sets that we're choosing from are simply all the subsets of A. If we take every subset of A, we're allowed to define a function that takes in a subset and returns a single chosen element from that subset. And finally, Form 4 states, let A be a set such that, first, each member of A is a non-empty set, and second, any two distinct members of A are disjoint. Then there exists a set C containing exactly one element from each member of A. Again, this form is just saying, if A is a set of sets, we can choose one element from each of those sets and put them all together in a separate set, which is called C. Hopefully it makes sense how all these forms are the same, but it did take me a little while to understand it myself, so I would highly encourage you to look at the example problems linked in the description for a bit more practice with all these different forms of the axiom of choice. Now it's time to move on to the last two forms of the axiom of choice. Form 5 is also known as cardinal comparability. It says that for any sets C and D, either C is smaller than or the same size as D, or D is smaller than or the same size as C. Another way of saying this is for any two cardinal numbers, kappa and lambda, either kappa is less than or equal to lambda, or lambda is less than or equal to kappa. So this touches on something that we'll look at in the next lesson called well ordering, and it's not super important right now, except to sort of understand the common sense behind it and be able to use it. Cardinals are just numbers, and so every pair of numbers has one that's greater, or they're both equal. And finally, Form 6 of the Axiom of Choice is known as Zorn's Lemma, and this one is a little more complicated. It states, let A be a set such that for every chain B, which is a subset of A, the union of B is also in A. Then, A contains a maximal element M, where M is not a subset of any other set in A. B is called a chain if and only if, for any C and D in B, either C is a subset of D, or D is a subset of C. I like to visualize a chain as the nested rings of a tree. Each ring is totally enclosed within every ring outside of it, and it totally encloses every ring inside of it. Similarly to Form 5, Zorn's lemma cannot be proven without some concepts from the next lesson, namely partial orderings and transfinite recursion, but the important thing for now is that we accept that it's true and we understand what it means. So what does it mean? Well, we have our chain B with all its elements nested inside one another. Zorn's lemma starts by saying, for every chain B which is a subset of A. Ah, so this chain is a subset of some outer ring A. Then Zorn's lemma says, the union of B is in A. Since all of the sets in B are nested inside one another, the union of B is simply this outer ring, the maximal element of B. Now, we can really only call it the maximal element of B if B is finite, because if B is infinite, by definition, it doesn't have a maximal element. But for the purposes of understanding Zorn's lemma, we're gonna sort of ignore that for now and just call it the maximal element, even though we know it might not technically exist. So the union of B is in A. What Zorn's lemma tells us is that if for every chain in A, the maximal element of that chain is also in A, then A itself must contain a maximal element. Once again, I don't exactly have a satisfying explanation for why this is true, because we need more knowledge to actually prove it, but I will definitely try to include a proof, or at least a really good explanation of Zorn's lemma, in the next lesson's example problems. So that's the axiom of choice. Very important, somewhat confusing, but pretty cool overall. I hope you enjoyed this video, let me know what you think, and if there's anything that would make it better. And remember to check out the example problems for a little bit more practice on how to apply these axioms. Thanks for watching, see you in 2 weeks.